anyone you want. You pick the one you're comfortable.
I have to give kudos to the kids of the UU Church.
Yay. That's great. Yay.
And I have to tell you, I just love the positive witness that I see so often with the UU congregations. My first year to march in Pride was not this past one, but the year before in Atlanta. And I was there with my late partner, David, and we're having a great time. We came around the corner to the first group of haters, and it was like, you know, there's no way to prepare yourself for that. And the little ladies on the float of the UU Church right in front of us just squealed with laughter, went running towards these guys with their signs, getting their pictures taken. I thought that this guy was going to swallow his tongue when they started running over there like that. They just handled it with such a sense of humor, with such grace. It was wonderful. Well, you know, the little kid was coming to, and I have to admit that I'm a recovering Baptist preacher. Thank you. My name is Paul. Thank you. And, you know, the little kid came with his dad to his first time at church, and he wasn't sure of how this thing worked, and so dad looked at him as he was kind of trying to figure out things. He was whispering stuff to him, and he said, "Dad, what does it mean when they say, 'Let us pray'?" He says, "It means you bow your head and close your eyes until they say the amen." All right. "What does it mean when they pass the plate around?" "That means you put some money in it and it gets to you." So he put a few coins in it and went back to him and went on. "Dad, what does it mean when the preacher takes off his watch and puts it on the pulpit?" He says, "Son, as near as I can tell, that don't mean a damn thing." "And that is my tradition. However, it is a little nippy out here." I have a confession to make. I love old cemeteries. I'm talking the old Victorian type. I will say one thing about the older ones. They're not convenient. They had the big markers. And the modern cemeteries are not nearly as interesting. The epitaphs aren't as interesting. And they are made flat for the ground, not for the beauty of it, but for the convenience of the groundskeeper. This is so that the lawnmower can run over the top of you when you're gone, and they don't have to bust out a weed eater. But I can tell you that when I pass off this mortal coil, I'm going to reach the spot of stopping accommodating other people. It's going to be one of these standing stones, and you're just going to have to bust out the weed eater. I'm sorry. You know, you get to that spot, but I digress. I love old cemeteries, and the first church that I served had one of these really old ones stretching out behind the edifice. And I love to look at the old epitaphs. One of them I found was actually a common Scottish epitaph. Spidery, scripted scrawl across the stone said, "Consider, friend, as you pass by. For as you are, so once was I. And as I am, so shall ye be. Prepare thyself to follow me." Oh my God. Somebody, I don't know who, had come along behind and scribbled in pencil beneath, "To follow you, I'm not content until I know which way you went." I kind of like that. And today, what I'd like to do is to take a brief look at where we've been. And we'll look at where we are, how far we've come, and where we're going to go from here. A bundle of sticks, worthless for anything but burning. In the old Gaelic, we get the word faggot, a useless bundle of dry sticks. In the history of the word, it came to be associated with an old woman carrying such a bundle of sticks into the village. And somewhere along the way, that became applied as a derogatory towards a gay man. Worthless for anything but burning. From the time of Constantine forward, for the next 1500 years, gay persons were burned all across the Europe at the stake. We think of the Inquisition as burning heretics, but actually, amongst those that were burned, it was estimated there was probably far more homosexual individuals being burned at the stake than actual heretics. For example, Joan of Arc was charged with the sin of wearing pants, which was against the Word of God. One of the central questions often was not whether or not to burn them, but rather to kill them first or let them be burned alive. The Piazza San Marco, or St. Mark's Square in Venice, it's beautiful. On one side of the square, you will see the emblem, the column of St. Theodore with his crocodile. And on the other side, you'll see the beautiful winged column of a lion that symbolizes Venice itself. And between these two lovely columns in this beautiful place, down by the canals with the sea out in front of you, were more gay people burned between those stakes than in all of Europe up until the time of the Holocaust. The love that dare not speak its name. In 1895, this was how the love between Oscar Wilde and Lord Alfred Douglas was described. Wilde was imprisoned for gross indecency, and this led to his later death, the conditions in prison. Between 1933 and 1945, Germany's Nazi government under Adolf Hitler used its monopoly of authority to target more than 1 million German men who the state asserted carried a degeneracy that threatened the disciplined masculinity of Germany. 100,000 men were arrested. 50,000 men served prison terms as convicted homosexuals. An unknown number were institutionalized. Hundreds were castrated under court order. Analysis of records suggests that between 5,000 to 15,000 homosexual men were imprisoned in concentration camps where they died from starvation, disease, exhaustion, beatings, and murder. While we're in World War II, July the 9th, 1941, Alan Turney, a British cryptologist, broke the German Enigma code. This allowed the British military to know when Germany was going to be attacking and to prepare for air raids. In 1945, he was awarded the Order of the British Empire. And in 1952, he was convicted of the crime of homosexuality and forced into treatment for his disorder. This treatment resulted in his suicide in 1954, just shortly before his 42nd birthday. In the 1950s, Senator Joe McCarthy was prosecuting the communists all over the United States. And we're quite familiar with the Red Scare, but very often we forget about the Lavender Scare. He asserted that homosexuals were very likely communist sympathizers and were in the employ of communists. All over Washington, people were being forced into resignation or being threatened with exposure as being gay or simply suspected of being gay. The Lavender Threat even resulted in government education films that were sent out to schools in order to warn children away from the dangerous lurking homosexual who might be prowling about looking for an opportunity to victimize them. Some of that thinking unfortunately exists to this day. The Stonewall Riots, 1969. Brief synopsis. How many of you are familiar with Stonewall? Oh, good. When I was telling the students with the GSA the first time I said about Stonewall Day, they were like, huh? Here we were in June the 28th of 1969. Stonewall Inn was a popular gay bar. It was frequently, routinely raided by the police. People were roughed up, their names were taken down, printed in the local newspaper, hustled off to the police station for the crime of dancing with another man or dancing with another woman. And the signal was that when the lights were flashed, whatever drink you were holding, drop it to the floor, turn around and try to find a person of the opposite sex to dance with, or else you're likely to be arrested. This happened routinely. Now the myth, I don't know if it's true, the myth is that on this particular hot June night, it had been enough. And one of the drag queens, being pushed into the back of a paddy wagon, snapped the heel off a stiletto, and that was it, honey. Because as we all know from Dorothy, it doesn't matter whether you're a good witch or a bad witch, baby. It's all about the shoes. When she was last seen, she was sitting on the cop's chest, hitting him with the shoe. The Stonewall riots lasted for 3 days. The actual police officers that had come to rough up the bar had to barricade themselves in the bar, push a policewoman out to the window of the bathroom, who then ran to the police station several blocks away to get reinforcements. This changed everything. And the next year, there were pride, what became known as the Pride celebrations, in major cities all across the United States. Since that humble beginning, pride has become a thing around the world. Sadly, on the 40th anniversary of the Stonewall riots in 2009, the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission conducted an unprovoked raid on a Fort Worth gay bar. So we're still not quite out of it. On Sunday, June the 24th, 1973, the final day of Pride in New Orleans, was the largest mass murder of gay persons in the United States by an arsonist. And yet most people aren't aware that 33 people perished in a bar purposefully set on fire. It was passively investigated, and the person that they knew to be responsible for this escaped from the hospital where he's placed for observation, and although he was seen in the French Quarter routinely, was never again picked up by the police. Well, that's where we've been. How about today? Things are better, aren't they? We see Ellen on television routinely. Things are better, but here's where we stand. The death penalty is enacted in Mauritania, Sudan, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Uganda, and Iran for the crime of loving a person of the same sex. Sadly, much of this persecution is being fueled by falsified research from American anti-gay activists. Hate crimes in a 14-year period, there were 15,351 anti-gay hate crimes, amounting to 17.4% of the national total. Some of the statistics that Reverend Joe Crisco was stating are very much in front of us. In 2010, a lot of us were alarmed by a seeming rash, a series of suicides amongst gay youth. Now, I want to clarify something as a counselor very quickly. Being gay doesn't make you suicidal. Lack of support, being bullied, being pushed around, being abused, and having nowhere to turn could make you suicidal. Being gay doesn't make you suicidal. Sadly, 1/3 of transsexuals in the United States commit suicide, and one transsexual per month across the United States by the USA Today survey of 2011 is killed in a hate crime, one per month. In Alabama, we would like to think that the murder of Billy Jack Gaither would so scald the conscience of Alabamians that it would never happen again, but a mere 5 years later, we witnessed the death of Scotty Joe Weaver, an 18-year-old Bay Minette man who was beaten, strangled, stabbed numerous times, partially decapitated, his body doused with gasoline and set on fire. And in 2011, we saw a young lady outside an Opelika bar beaten for the crime, once again, of loving someone of the same sex. Despite Federal Hate Crimes Act, this Matthew Shepard law, crimes against persons because of their sexual orientation or identity is not covered under Alabama hate laws, Alabama hate crimes law. And although the U.S. Supreme Court has decriminalized same-sex sexual activity across the United States in 2003, the Alabama state legislature has never repealed our sodomy laws. Okay, there's where there's where we've been. How about how far we've come? Since the 1969 Stonewall riots, Pride's observed in every major city in the United States. From that ragged little bunch of folks in Greenwich Village, in New York, Chicago, West Hollywood, Dallas, Houston, Atlanta, Miami, St. Petersburg, and San Diego, they routinely hit around 100,000 people coming to celebrate Pride. And internationally, it's even bigger. São Paulo, Brazil has grown to about 4 million people who come to celebrate Pride in Brazil. as of January 2013, 9 states had enacted laws that said same-sex marriage could be performed in their states, as well as the District of Columbia. And 2 Native American tribes have done the same thing. Just over 3 weeks ago, legislators in Hawaii put forward a bill from their House and their Senate to legalize same-sex marriage in Hawaii. And on Valentine's Day, just behind us, a bill was approved. Where was it? Illinois? I can't read my own writing. In Illinois, to legalize same-sex marriage. And this is going forward before their legislature. And I'm pleased to say that in 2011, on a beach on a beautiful day like this, out near Provincetown, I married the world's most wonderful man. Things aren't as bad as they were. Things are better in some ways, and perhaps better now than they've ever been, but things aren't what they could be. I have to go on to say, a recent EEOC ruling says that it is illegal to discriminate against a trans person in the workplace, and based on this ruling, it looks as though the EEOC will extend that to persons of same-sex orientation. This is big news. Don't Ask, Don't Tell in 1993 was put into place by some people with the idea that we're going to use this to keep people from being discriminated against in the military. And it became a witch hunt. And we can be pleased to say that in September the 20th of 2011, it was repealed, and our military personnel can serve out and proudly in the U.S. military.
Yes.
So where from here? Seeing that, as St. Paul said, we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, how shall we live? What shall we do? And what can we take from all of this? I want to suggest a couple of things. I want to go back to my fascination with old cemeteries. It has that starting date. It has an ending date. And in between, whatever you've done, however your life is described, is captured in that one little hyphen. A dash between the dates. How is your dash of life going? And how will it be inscribed? That dash is short, it's indelible, there's no redos, you don't get to do it all over again, and it's inscribed for each one of us. How will it be inscribed? I turn to my choice of grave marker once again, too. I choose not to be convenient. Now, this doesn't mean that I go out of my way to be obnoxious, although some people would suggest that I manage to do that quite naturally. And we don't go out of our way to be unpleasant, disagreeable, or whatnot. However, we can say that well-behaved people have rarely made history. Recently, a young person in one of our state schools who was having trouble because of his sexual orientation, it was suggested to him, well, dude, can you just be a little less, obvious? Budget up a little bit? So what we've done there is we've just blamed the victim. This kid's being abused for being himself, and we're blaming the victim. Butch it up a little bit. I like the t-shirt that I've seen. Some of you have probably seen it that says this. I don't mind straight people. I just wish they'd act gay in public. It makes as much sense. Have you ever noticed, by the way, that when couples are together, they don't have to say anything? Very often, they seem to kind of telegraph that they're a couple without being overly obvious or anything else like that. You ever notice that? Their body language, the way they sit with each other, those little unspoken things that says we're a part of one another. David and I were going to Hawaii, and we're sitting on the plane, and we're just across the way from this other side, and I am sitting, and I've turned to talk to David, who's sitting next to the window, and he said, "That woman keeps looking at us." I said, "Really?" "Yes, she's just staring at us." I said, "Is she still staring?" He said, "Yes." And I planted one kiss on him that made the lady of the evening blush with shame. I said, "Is she still looking?" He said, "No." I said, "Good." The fact of the matter is that if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. if we don't ask for anything here that any citizen of the United States of America does not expect by virtue of simply being a human being, to live, to love, to express that love without fear, to hold hands, to talk about those that we care about in casual conversation, to marry, to live. We're not asking for extraordinary things, but things that people across the United States take for granted on a daily basis. That marker, start date, end date, middle dash. It's short, it's indelible, it's written in stone. Consider this. Well, it was battered and scarred, and the auctioneer felt was hardly worth his while to waste much time on the old violin, but he held it up with a smile. Well, it sure ain't much, but it's all we've got left. I guess we ought to sell it too. Now who'll make a bid on this old violin? Just one more and we'll be through. Then he cried, one, give me $1. Who'll make it two? Only $2, we'll make it three. $3 twice, that's a good price, but who's got a bid for me? Raise up your hand and don't wait any longer. The auction's about to end. Who's got four? Just $1 more to bid on this old violin. Well, the air was hot and the people stood around as the sun was setting low. From the back of the crowd, a gray-haired man came forward and picked up the bow. He wiped the dust from the old violin and tightened up the strings and played out a melody pure and sweet as the angels sing. Then the music stopped, and the auctioneer, in a voice that was quiet and low, said, what is my bid for this old violin? And he held it up with the bow. Then he cried, one, give me 1,000, who'll make it two? Only 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 twice, and that's a good price, but who's got a bid for me? The people called out, what made the change? We don't understand. The auctioneer stopped and said with a smile, it was the touch of the master's hand. Now you know many a man with life out of tune is battered and scarred with sin, and he's auctioned cheap to a thankless world, much like the old violin. And the master comes, and the foolish crowd can never understand the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of the master's hand. Imagine that. You, whatever your faith tradition, whatever your philosophy, you might be a theist, you might be an atheist, you might be Christian, pagan, Hindu, doesn't matter. You're a person of worth, and there's something integral about you that is of worth, that we are possessed of greatness, and there is something great within us, whatever that may be. There is greatness in us. We cannot be consumed by petty differences. We have to be united in our common interests. We cannot lie down, and we cannot be silent when we see injustice. Recently, a young fellow posted a blog, I think that it was in Irondale, Alabama, and he may be here today, was talking about being called out by someone in the public, said, hey, faggot, and then was beaten on the streets of Irondale. This happened recently. We can't be silent. In 1770, the political philosopher Edmund Burke was quoted as saying, all that is necessary for the triumph of evil is that good men do nothing. And this is my challenge for you today. Make your dash count. Don't let your dash count for nothing. Be the person who speaks up against injustice. Be the person who stands out and says, I'll be counted. Be the person who says, I'll not be silent. Of all the sad words of tongue or pen, the saddest are these. It might have been. Make a count. For the sake of those that have passed before us and can no longer speak for themselves,
and for the sake of those who come after us that need our support and need our strength, make it count. I wish you well, Montgomery. I wish you well, Alabama. And thank you very much for this opportunity.